And we're live.
Hello and welcome. I have an interactive session planned for you today. So if you would like to join me, do feel free to organize your special cello chair, cello and bow, keep it close by, and I'll give you a few moments to organize this. I have an interactive session planned for you today.
Let's spend a little time.
To join me
before starting with this simple movement.
To organize your special cello chair, cello and bow, keep it close by, and I'll give you a few moments to organize this. I have an interactive session planned for you today.
William, I'm getting feedback.
How is it now?
That's better. Thank
okay,
you.
Great.
Yeah, I was hearing my voice at the same time as I was speaking. Okay, if you might remember this from the last cello chat, we take the right hand, tuck it under your left armpit and vice versa. And you think of your thumbs pointing up and the fingers of both hands pointing back. So you're just gently directing the hands back and the thumb up. That's it. And you rest your shoulders on your hands. This is a lovely way to come to quiet. In the first talk of this four-part series, I spoke about the importance of finding the ground and finding our center. The ground provides the stability for our movement, and finding our center along the vertical upward line, learning to go up along the spinal column, is the key to our balance and freedom. William, would you like to introduce slide number 2?
Sure, give me 1 second.
Thank you. Finding the ground and finding our center opens the door to the principle of opposition. As soon as we begin to move one way, we must make use of the opposing force to stabilize us within the movement. Opposition, this against that, gives us several advantages in movement. It gives us firmness with flexibility, and it gives us strength with agility. And agility is simply ease of movement. This principle of opposition operates in the coordinated musician in such a way that the limbs remain free of unnecessary tension, whilst the large muscles of the back deliver power to the arms and hands to play the instrument. I call opposition the principle of true measure. So let me start with a simple example. Hi, William, could we have slide number 3? Thank you. When traveling in remote areas of Eastern Turkey, I came across the use of old-fashioned scales in their covered fruits and vegetable markets. If you asked for half a kilo of oranges, the fruit seller placed a corresponding half kilo weight on the left side of the scale and then loaded the fruit onto the right until the scale was evenly balanced. That's how they calculated the true measure of what you paid for, although they almost always threw in a bit extra. To experience the true measure of effort needed for an activity, It pays to explore how this principle of opposition works in the human body. This against that. So, simple demonstration. I take a short rope and I pull the opposite ends. This hand goes that way, this hand goes that way. Now, if you can balance the pull between the two hands and begin to diminish the effort through quiet attention, doing less and less and less, each side begins to receive a message from the other side. What is just the amount of effort required in the back and between the two hands to maintain the tension of the rope? Not too much and not too little. This against that. Something you can try now is the opposition between your two hands. So if you take your two forefingers and you hook them together and you pull your elbows gently apart, you have that same opposition at work in the body. You reverse, you might be able to sense something slightly different. One hand is above the other, but there's still opposition between the two fingers. Now hook your pinky finger into your forefinger and gently pull apart. And then switch over. Alexander's name for this principle of opposition as it operates in the human body is antagonistic action. He called it the great principle. One part of the body against another in balance. The head forward and up against the back, back and up. The hips back and the knees away. Head against back, hips against knees. Antagonistic action describes how the parts of our body work together in harmony as one. If you remember, we explored this concept in the very first cello chat. The relationship of the head to the body is called the primary control. And the primary control is activated through antagonistic action. Head forward and up, back, back and up, hips back, knees away. When the primary control is working properly, coordinated movement is the result. I found a quote for you from a pupil of Alexander about antagonistic action. It's very, very clear, so I want to share it with you. Alexander said, "We are too imbued with the idea of flexing, an act involving too much of collapse and shortening, through bringing into play only the contractors or flexors. In fact, both extensors and flexors must first come into play together. The balanced pull extending the joint and the pull maintained during the movement." Now, these are only words to you at the moment. Head forward and up, back, back and up, hips back, knees away. But were you to begin the study of the Alexander technique, the actual psychophysical, the mind-body experience of these words in practice, through years of lessons, grows within you until you embody this dynamic balance. You are an instrument with sensing and moving capabilities. The term is sensorimotor. But in many of us, our capabilities are rudimentary and undeveloped. With work, they can become exquisitely tuned and sensitive, which makes for powerful and efficient movement, what is called ease. So, sitting in the principle of opposition, you can see the child on the left is sitting up without really any effort. It just quite natural for a child of that age to sit up unless they have damage to their central nervous system. They will find that beautiful upward balance. As we get older, we start to do what the young lady's doing on the left, collapsing. But it is possible to recover that upward flow along the spine with awareness, with consciousness, that it exists and that it is working in us all the time. It's we who go away from it. I found this picture in the newspaper shortly after, the one on the right, shortly after I moved to England, and I was absolutely amazed. This is the Queen Mother at 100. There she is, sitting up, as fresh as a daisy, and looking out. Maybe it was all the gin she drank, I don't know, but it's a remarkable picture. Her daughter doesn't look like that, Queen Elizabeth. Now this is a, I believe, a Buddhist monk with a novice on the left. A novice is a beginner, and you can see the difference in the energy along the spine. You can see the head slightly pulling back and the collapse in the spine. But over time and with practice, that novice has a chance to look like and live like, more importantly, the monk at the center. And here's our favorite cellist of old times, Emmanuel Forman, sitting up beautifully with seemingly no effort. Now, the internal directions for opposition, we can practice them now. If you're sitting, place your feet under your knees. And hopefully you have a hard chair so that you can get feedback from your sitting bones. You know from my previous lectures that I love my hard stool because it helps me find my sitting bones. So if you have your hard stool and you can sit with your sitting bones balanced under you, you can think about your head up to the sky and feet down into the earth. You can think your head up and your back back. Your shoulders, not yet, William, just one second. Your shoulders east and west, this way. Your head up and your sitting bones down into the chair. Your hips back and your knees away. So I give myself those directions every morning before I practice, just to renew the opposition, to find it again. It's always possible to find it again and again and again. It renews itself with our attention. For young cellists, I sometimes draw the analogy with learning the positions on the fingerboard. So as you progress on the instrument, you learn the vertical positions connect to the horizontal positions so that you gain a full sensory awareness and spatial awareness of moving about on the cello. It becomes second nature. With years of practice, awareness of yourself as you move in space can become second nature too. Now we're ready, William, for our next slide.
Meet Flower. She's the leader of a 29-strong family of meerkats, known as the Whiskers. She's just a foot tall.
And there she is, sitting beautifully up, balancing, ready for her cello. let's move on to our relationship with the cello and the principal. One second, William. Let's move on to our relationship with the cello and how the principle of opposition operates there. I use another analogy here, that of ballroom dancing, the relationship with your partner. Hanging on and holding on tightly to your partner are the sins of beginners. In a good dance partnership, there is opposition. You learn to go against your partner, but not to hang on. So this against that. Without opposition, you have no possibility to move freely across the dance floor as one. You have to learn what it means to stay in opposition to your dance partner at all times. And the same is true with our cello, our partner in crime. Stay back against the cello to remain plugged in to your power source, which is your back. Now, I have a little excerpt of my favorite dancer, Fred Astaire, but he's dancing alone this time. I want you to watch for two things: the firmness of his back as his arms move about, and the opposition of his back to his instrument, which in this case is his walking stick. Putting on the Ritz, which somebody very cleverly aligned with Smooth Criminal. He never danced that to Smooth Criminal, but it's been superimposed and it's incredible how well it fits. Anyway, you saw his moves in relation to his walking stick. He's throwing the stick, he's moving this way, but his back is very firm and stays back and away. And that's opposition, very simply. William, could we have slide 10? Thank you. Now, take a good long look at this because we're going to be working with it in just a minute. As you look at it, you can connect your left hand to your right foot, your right hand to your left foot, just through thinking. And where they cross, those lines, is your center. And you can add a vertical line running through the center. you, William. Okay, if you want to take your cellos up, we can try a few things. We're going to start with just the instrument, not the bow. And as you bring it in, if you can bring it from the right side, from the opposite side, you can maintain your line, your center line. I quite like this, and I work with my young people this way too, because oftentimes when people bring the cello in from the left, they learn to do all kinds of twists and turns. But this side is quite free of habit. It's non-habitual, so it's useful. It can teach us something about what our habits are. Now, as you sit with the instrument, you can think about that big X, the opposition of the left foot and the right hand. The right foot and the left hand. Awareness of your center and your vertical line. Now, from your center, you can bring your hands out to the sides. One palm up and the other palm down. So you've got an awareness of the ground and the sky. And then you reverse. The ground and the sky. So you're maintaining awareness of two opposing planes, up and down. Now as you move your fingers up one way, you can think of the fingers growing into the ground. They grow up to the sky, into the ground. The opposition between the two hands. You come back, turn, and move the other way. Again, the opposition between the two sets of fingers is very important. Good. Take a moment just to let that settle. And now you find the string. You find your upper string with your left hand and your lower string with your right, and you move up and down in opposition to one another. You can stay up there and stay down there and up there. And then you come back. And then you meet at the center. You can take your hands, pull one way against the other. Switch them around, pull one way against the other. And all the time you can be thinking of your left foot against your right hand and your right foot against your left hand. Good. Now take a same string, let's choose the G string, and you're going to pull with your left hand against the pull with your right hand. So you're actually pulling on the same string, pulling it apart. Again, you're judging how much you need. You don't need a lot of force. You can let go of quite a lot. Emptying your arms and being aware of your back. Then you take your two thumbs and you push the same string. You push with your right thumb to the left and you push with your left thumb to the right. And over the years that I practice this, I can actually gently use this exercise to allow my back to expand and connect into that power source. Once more, you pull the string left and right with those two fingers, first and second finger, and then you push with your thumbs. It's very important that you don't tighten the arms to do this. You'll defeat the purpose of the exercise if you tighten the arms. Okay, let's put our cellos down for the moment. and take up our bows. So, working the opposition between the thumb and fingers, I like to put my two fingers in front and put the third and fourth behind the stick, and that way I isolate the thumb one and two, which is what I call a powerhouse on the bow. It's what's responsible for producing that connection to the string. I call these the guiding fingers. They're more important as guides, but this is the powerhouse, thumb one and two. Now, if you have a cheap bow, it's better than using your turret for this. You're going to hook your thumb into the tip, underneath the tip there, underneath the wood, and your other two fingers this way, and you're going to pull the bow in opposite directions. So you're literally going like that, that way. And now you take your two fingers of your left hand, you push against the tip, and you push with both hands towards the middle. So the opposition this time is this way, not this way, but that way. Call this the push and the pull. And this is what happens. This is what the string gives you, the resistance the string gives you when you play. So you're learning to create that in your own body. Now we do it in the vertical, pulling away from the center, pushing into the center. We do it on the diagonal with a frog down. We do it on the diagonal with a frog up. Pull and push and pull and push. We do it over our heads. Pull and push. Behind our neck. Pull and push. And behind our back. Pull and push. And each plane of action gives you a different sense of how you can find that opposition in your own body. Now the next exercise comes from Margaret Roll, and you'll need your cello and your bow for this. It's a lovely one. You need your three fingers of your left hand, and you place it on the outside of your right wrist. You pull with the left hand, you pull with your left hand against the right wrist. So you're setting up this against that. You do the same with the thumb inside the right wrist, so that you're pushing against your thumb and your thumb pushes against your wrist. So once more, pull the outside of the wrist and send your right wrist into your fingers, and then use your thumb against the inside of your wrist. Good. All right, the next one is called opposing the string. With the left thumb, you pull your string to the left. And with a bow in the right hand, you pull the string to the right. So it's this against that, this against that. You're picking up and intensifying the resistance that the string provides. Then you reverse the movement. You push the string into the bow and the bow into the string. That's your up bow. The French have a great word for it. They call it pousser, which means to push, literally. And the tiré is to draw. So you're drawing the bow that way. So it's this and that. All the time you're creating opposition, you're intensifying the opposing forces. And your body's learning through that how to create power without effort. Now, I'm quite fond of using a big black practice mute, if you have one. By all means do. I rest the bow against it. And you can work with your weight transfer and the bow stick and pedaling with the feet. So as you draw the bow in one direction, you lift off your right foot. So you're at the tip of the bow with only your left foot on the ground. And your spine is turning in that direction, the opposite direction to the weight-bearing foot. Then as you come back, you take your left foot off and now you're facing the opposite way to the right foot, which is weight-bearing. And this turning on your spine is happening all the time when you're playing, the pedaling in the feet, this way and that. But it's important that you don't go in the same direction because that's not opposition. Opposition is moving in the opposite direction so that you have the power and force available to you from your back. Now, the last one, actually there are two more. The bow pull, you pull the bow to the right as you pull to the left with your left hand. So you're creating again this force. And I do this by measuring the distance of the bow, moving in inches. I'm pulling in opposition all the time on the down bow until I arrive at the end of the stick. And then to come back, I'm pushing in towards the center. This way, again towards the center, towards the center. Those are Texas inches. I usually go a little bit smaller distances. And finally, one that I have called balance me up, which you can move the left hand and the bow in opposing directions. So you start with the bow on the C string and your left hand on the A string. Already this is not habitual. You never play, or very rarely I should say, play on a string that you're not bowing. So here we go. You're moving up, staying there, and then moving back and forward and back and forward. So you're getting that sense of distance between the two hands here, and then distance here. Then you can start with the hands together and come back. So now you're at opposing ends with your two hands. Then you can switch strings. So now you're on the upper string, and here you are with your left hand on the lower string. And again, you're in opposition through your back. Your back is firm, and it's sending the power through to your fingers. And I think that is the end. William, can you show slide number 11, please? It's Picasso's vision of opposition. There you have it, complete. In all directions. Thank you. I think we have some time for questions.
Selma, could you check the chat box, please?
Yeah. Desiree, good evening. Yes, it's possible. I'm happy to send you them. They're things I've made up, but they're not Alexander per se, but they're certainly perfectly useful to illustrate the principles. So yes, I'm happy to do that for you. Yes, I will. We'll organize that with William. Can we do that, William?
I can give Desiree your email if that's okay.
Perfect. Okay, that sounds good.
While we're waiting for questions to come in, feel free to talk about something else related to your lecture.
Sure. Sure. I would like to say that I'm a small build person. And all my life as a student, I was told that my arms are too short to get to the tip properly. And it wasn't until I got into the Alexander work, and I'm going to demonstrate this for you, that I actually realized that there is no such thing as arms that are too short. There's just not enough knowledge about using the back properly. So I'm going to show you something. I hope it'll be visible on the screen. I normally can demonstrate this much more easily in person. But if I want to start at the frog and then cross the middle and approach the tip, what I have to learn to do is rotate my back so that I can just keep on going and keep on going and keep on going, and my arm is still comfortably here. But I'm using my back properly, whereas if I don't use my back and I don't rotate, I get this. Now I'm running out of space. I'm running out of space, running out of space, and it's a real effort. And you notice that I've started to rotate up here, which is not good. So I solved a problem that I actually never had. That's the funny thing about it. It wasn't a problem. It was that I was misusing myself. So I encourage you to learn to use your back properly if you're a small bone person, because it gives you tremendous power without strain. And who doesn't want that? I think we have another question. I'm going to turn these lights down. Would I explain again what I did with the bow and the foot? Okay, sure. It's called pedaling. I mean, you can call it what you want. I call it pedaling. But basically, when I start at the frog, my weight is more or less centered. But as I move the arm away from my body, the weight has to go onto my left foot, because it has to oppose the movement of the arm, which is going away from the body. So to intensify that, I lift my right leg, and that really puts the onus on the left leg and foot to stabilize me, to do its work. So I lift the left, the right foot, and go into the left foot. And I do the opposite as I come back. I lift my left leg so that I can really go into my right foot, because I'm going that way. So I want to oppose the movement with my right foot. I hope that's clear. If it's not, you can write to me. I'll try to do a better job of explaining it. Let's see what we have. Question from Angela. When you drew the full bow and said that the weight at the tip was on the left foot, didn't you mean the weight should be on the right foot?
If I'm at the tip of the bow on a down bow, no, I mean it should be on the left foot, most definitely. It needs to be on the opposing side. You understand, when your arm leaves the body, it goes to the right. Your weight needs to be on the opposing side. It needs to stabilize you. Otherwise, you get this, and you're going down. If you're moving with the weight, you're going down. You've got to move against the weight and keep back and keep up. Question from Alejandro. I would like to know how to find the balance between weight and speed in low strings to pass the bow quickly with good sound. Well, I would say, where are you first? That would be what I would say. Where are you? Are you in opposition to the string? Because then you can have some control about weight and speed. It's a complex issue, and there are no simple answers, but you have to start with yourself. What is my relationship to my cello? Where am I? Am I in opposition to my instrument, or am I collapsing over it? Thank you, Corey. Glad I could be of help. Question from Jennifer. I'm sorry I missed the beginning. You probably mentioned it, but what do you recommend in terms of seat height? I feel that I've been sitting on seats that are too large all my life. Too large? Do you mean too tall? I'm not particularly tiny, but the cello was never stable until I moved to a mini-max stool in a normal chair. I couldn't push against one foot without becoming unbalanced. Well, I think you should have your hips slightly higher than your knees. That's my general rule of thumb. Just a little bit higher, not a lot. But that allows for a fall of the knee away from the hip, and also a freer joint. But really, what you have to do is be mindful of how you are using your pelvic structure to balance you. That's most important. Ivy. Oh, that's nice. That's really good. I'm glad you're taking up the cello again after the pandemic. It's your best friend. It's been my best friend in the pandemic, for sure.
Well, I think that's all the questions we have for right now, but I will leave your contact info. Is it okay for me to leave your email? And
yes, that's fine.
If anyone has any questions.
I'm going to send you the email I'd like you to share. It's to my website.
Sure.
Yeah. So I'll send you that as soon as we disconnect.
Great. All right.
Thank you, William. And bye, everybody. I'll see you next time. It's number 3 is called Powerful Back, Light Arms. That sounds like an oxymoron, but it isn't. Tune in. Bye.